Sir, that's my signifier for quietness. All right, so hello, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Sculpture Department's Visiting Artist Lecture. This evening we have Alex Da Corte with us, and he's gonna share some magical words. A little background, Da Corte is an artist from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. His work has been exhibited in solo shows, including A Man Full of Trouble at the Macaroon Gallery in New York, 50 Wigs at the Herning Gallery Museum of Contemporary Art, A Season in Heel at the Art and Practice Hammer Museum in LA, Free Roses at Mass MoCA, Les Morts Vivants, don't speak French, I hope that wasn't too bad. His collaborative work, Eastern Sports with Jason Musson, is currently on view at the Whitney Museum of American Art as part of Dreamlands, an immersive cinema and art. He received his MFA from Yale University in 2010 and was awarded a Pew Fellowship in 2010. On behalf of the Sculpture Department, please join me in welcoming Alex Da Corte.
Thank you, everybody, for having me. This is a picture of some sculptures. This is when I was at Yale University, thinking about, stuff. When I went to study sculpture, I didn't know what I was doing. I still don't. But I think I liked thinking about bongs at the time. And thinking, I want to make things the way people make bongs. I want to feel a certain kind of rage and anxiety and desire to make these things the same way someone would concoct a bong to get the drugs they need. I have tattoos. I like tattoos. Tattoos are kind of beautiful because they exist in time for a really long time, and they can be undone, but it's hard to see them go away. I was thinking about touch when I was flying over here yesterday from Philadelphia, and thinking how all day long I'm touching my phone, and all day long I'm touching people's lives, and they're touching mine, but we're never really touching. And thinking about, like, what does it mean to like something, and what does it mean to engage in the world, and how do you touch through a screen? How do you touch more? And sometimes I wish I could touch through a screen. There was this game that I would play when I was younger with my brother. This is my brother standing in front of this mural that he painted at the foot of our bed. It's Jaws. And my mom is kind of perverse in the sense that she loves movies and she loves horror movies. And we would play this game where we would watch Jaws, and we lived at the beach, by the beach, and we'd watch Jaws at night, and then we would go night swimming at midnight, and she would make us all go night swimming. And I thought that was really obscene and not something I liked to do, but I thought it was like a really beautiful thing where she wanted to take the movies and like bring them into our lives because it would make our lives romantic like the movies are. And I think that that's kind of beautiful, despite the fact that it was completely insane. And I've always liked thinking about that, about how the pictures that we look like, or the pictures that we look at, are like a skin or a sort of a facsimile of the thing that it is in real life. You know, an image of an object versus an object. And that we also have a kind of skin around us that is hiding something, like a mask. I watch Scream nearly every night. It's something I love because it's about the phone, and I kind of think about phones all the time. I think Drew Barrymore's cool, and it was a neat movie when it came out, and I saw this when I was in high school, because they sort of advertised her as the star, and then she, you know, spoiler alert, gets brutally murdered in the beginning, and she's kind of stalked by this guy on the phone. And it was a neat thing to see when I was younger, because I was thinking, wow, like, this is like a movie within a movie that's like sort of revealing itself, or it's sort of acknowledging the audience, and it was one way of breaking through the screen. And phones too are a certain kind of way of breaking through time or space and collapsing it, because when you're talking to someone on the phone, it feels like they're there. And now that you can FaceTime and stuff, they like really are there, or at least a picture of them. This is just like a strange movie that she was in, but I was thinking about David Cronenberg, and he like has this really funny quote, or it's not even funny, but it says, when a kid is turned into a cat, if you try to relate to him as your son, disaster, emotional, psychic disaster. You've crossed the line. You've done wrong. Don't underestimate the seriousness of play, the necessity to have that fantasy. And every time I watch Scream, I think Drew Barrymore's gonna live. And that's strange, but I believe in that world that they created. And in some ways, she does live. This is an image of a prop I made, which is a facsimile of a prop that Tim Burton made for the movie Batman. And it's one of the parade floats that the Joker flies through Gotham City. I like to replicate props and sort of bring the movies into my life in the same way that floating in a dark water in the middle of the night brings Jaws to life. This is me as Eminem. I'll get back to that later. This is me as my grandma. I'll get back to that later as well. This is me as two extremely cool lesbians. This is from a film called The Bitter Tears of Petra von Kant. It's a Fassbender film, one of Warhol's favorite films, and kind of shaped my brain in terms of how to kind of stage things or think about the image or the things we see on TV or in the movies as an actual stage. This whole film takes place in her bedroom and she's tormented by her phone. This is me trying to touch these flowers. These flowers are not real. These are a facsimile of the Purple Rain, the Prince Purple Rain album. This is a man touching a sign, and the sign says 7-Eleven. And the 7-Eleven sells food, but there's no food here. This is a beautiful painting by Caillebeau of men touching the floor. And I love how they press against the floor. I think it's a beautiful thing to engage with the surfaces of a room because in some ways you're pushing against the boxes that we live in. And these boxes in some ways are like our mind. The first show that I did out of school, I took a bunch of these objects and laid them out like a graveyard. And I've always thought that objects hold touch and that you can't undo touch. And for me, working with these kinds of found objects, as they say in the world, which I think is a silly word, is in some ways trying to get to know them or understand who touched them before. And an object that exists in the world, however it comes into your life, is in some way like a tombstone of someone who's passed, or a relic. You can't run away from death. This is a beautiful sculpture, painting, performance by Polly Applebaum. And I think working against the floor and working with the floor and marrying yourself to the floor is, in some ways, not fashion. It's punk rock. I think it's sexy. I think it's radical, and I think it's charged. This is a man who was fixing a light at the Renoir Museum in Philadelphia, and he fell through the glass ceiling. This is a computer animation of the man on the floor, which I think is, he's okay, he got compensated, but it's really strange that they made this like facsimile of his experience. And I thought, how cool, I wish I was that guy. So the other side of the bedroom, my brother Americo drew the Jaws, and then I drew all the Disney villains around my bed. Because I wanted to be around these people who I thought at the time were my friends. I would paint their eyes glow in the dark, and when I turn off the lights, they'd look at me. And when I look at this picture, it's funny that I placed the Beast as one of the villains, because he was just misunderstood. And I have a thing for misunderstood men. Walt Disney made this really cool invention when he was working on Snow White and Seven Dwarfs called the multiplane camera. And what he would do is put a camera at the top of all of these layers of glass and shoot the camera through these different cells to create some kind of depth of field that was closer to what we experience in real life of walking through a space. Now, when I make these installations that I do and I walk through them, I believe that I'm walking through a single image, and that time is both expanding and flattening always. This is an image of a celluloid. And I always wanted to work in the ink and paint department at Walt Disney. And I thought it was beautiful that this thin piece of celluloid could be messy and kind of abstract on one side and really tight and kind of illustrative on the other. I think of my work as some sort of space between those two planes, kind of dipping back and forth. I found this collage the other day when I was like clearing out my mom's house and saw that this was the first collage I ever made. So when I was young, I would take these muscle magazines and I'd cut out all of the faces and all of the clothes that they were wearing or lack of clothes, and I'd lay them out and I'd kind of put the skins as close as I could together to simulate something that was, to me, erotic, and I was probably like 10 or 11. And then, this is so fucked up, I would hide them in my Walt Disney Encyclopedia of Animated Characters book. This is literally on the page of Bambi. I mean, it's Bambi, you know, it's like insane. It's like about this guy, and this deer, and his dad. It's like so fucked, and I just love it. But I thought, you know, I've always wanted to touch things. I've always wanted to like push through a picture plan. And I think Edward Marbridge did too. And I think so did Marisol. This is a beautiful sculpture by Marisol in which she has depicted time through stillness. A film from 1973 called Frank Film by Frank Morris highly influenced me. Frank and his wife Caroline made this film where they collaged together thousands upon thousands of magazine cutouts to depict his life. And what it taught me was that you can talk about your life and you can engage with the art world using the things you like, and that pleasure is something to embrace. I highly recommend this film. This is a picture of tomatoes. This is a picture of tomatoes and hot dogs. You cannot eat either of them. This is a picture of oranges. This is a picture of oranges in heaven. This is a Giotto painting of the Lamentation of Christ. And there's something really beautiful about flatness here, but also how flatness can be spiritual and kind of move beyond. This is a mural on the West Side Highway or the LA freeway. This is a piece of Michelangelo's The Last Judgment painting at the Sistine Chapel, in which he depicted St. Bartholomew holding his flayed skin. I think the flayed skin looks a lot like Michael Myers. This is me as Michael Myers. In 2010 through to 2011, I was out of school and I was kind of thinking, what do I do with my life? And I was living back at home with my parents, and I thought, how do you see the people that you love? How do you re-look at something? How does a urinal become famous? How does a Brillo box become famous? And there's this beautiful saying that is the opposite of déjà vu called jamais vu, which means to sort of see something for the first time. And we all have these moments in our life where they're slightly uncanny, where all of a sudden you'll see something familiar anew. And I kind of wanted to force this issue, so I was thinking about Michael Myers, and my family lives in the town that this movie Halloween takes place in, called Haddonfield. And I thought, and this film is kind of interesting because it was one of the first, like, first point of view films where in the beginning, as it starts, you are looking as though you're the eyes of this murderer. The camera literally places on a mask and you look through these eyes. And I thought, how cool, you know, like, watching that movie is like being there. And so I wanted to be there again. And so I dressed up like Michael Myers every night and walk around my neighborhood. And in the evening, when my parents were making dinner, I'd stand outside of the house and I'd watch them. And I was dressed in a full costume with the butcher knife. And they're not very good cooks, but... Oh, I'm sorry. Better, happier. Happy. It doesn't even matter. Anyway, they didn't know about it. Long story short. Oh God, that was sad. This is sort of what I thought I would do in my life. Make paintings. Yes, cast say not of hell. No, I thought I would make paintings like this. I thought this is sort of like the epitome of making, and this is my version of that. It's like a bong, and I think bongs are beautiful. And they do the same thing. These are just some quick sculptures of, like, portraits, I guess. I think about this work as portraiture and also bong making. There's a lot of images, so I'm just going to kind of move through. I think you can tell a lot about the way people comb their hair and cuff their pants and wear their sweatshirts. We all wear costumes, and I think houses wear costumes too. I think this is a version of a house costume. It is what I think of as my first sculpture, which is from around 2004, called Love Despite of Great Faults. And when I made it, it was just a picture, and those are my parents' Christmas trees, and they still use them. But in some ways, I think about it still. There's something really beautiful about the urgency in which people make things and make things without care. It's hard to make things when you're standing on your head, I think. This man takes all of my trash outside of my studio and paint that I throw away and paints these murals every holiday. I think they're cool. I love Philadelphia. That was. Love is like a sandwich, insofar as everybody wants a sandwich. And sandwiches have many layers. This is a hoagie that I made for a show with this artist, Borna Samak. And we made it sort of as an homage to Duchamp's Etant Donné. But really, I want to show you this. In 2010, I was asked by Leonard Cohen to make a film for his album, New Skin for the Old Ceremony. And he, with his daughter, Lorca, and we're kind of arranging this this group of artists to each make one video for one song off this album. And this was my first video. I'm gonna show you.
I remember you well. Chelsea Hotel. You were talking so brave and so sweet, giving me head on the unmade bed while the limousines wait in the street. Those were the reason that was New York. We were running for the money and the flesh, and that was called love for the workers in song. Probably still is for those of them left. Yeah, but you got away, didn't you, babe? You just turn your back on the crowd. You got away, I never once heard you say, I need you, I don't need you, I need you, I don't need you, and all of them jiving around. I remember you well in the Chelsea Hotel. You were famous, your heart was a legend. You told me again you preferred handsome men, but for me you would make an exception. And clenching your fist for the ones like us who are oppressed by the figures of beauty, you fixed yourself. You said, well, never mind, we are ugly, but we have the music. And then you got away, didn't you, baby? You just turned your back on the crowd. You got away, I never once heard you say, I need you, I don't need you, I need you. I don't need you, and all of that jiving around. I don't mean to suggest that I loved you the best. I can't keep track of each fallen robin. I remember you well in the Chelsea Hotel. That's all, I don't even think of you that often.
Oh my God, I'm such a jackass. I don't know how to do this. There we go. Cool. I still think that finger is so obscene. This is a picture of me as Eminem again. A strange thing happened to me in, oh, I don't know, a couple years ago when I was living in Paris, and a friend of mine sent me a photograph of me with the Mona Lisa at the Louvre. And I thought, oh yeah, I was there today. And I remember that photograph being taken, sure. And a few days later, I kind of re-examined the photograph and was like, oh no, that's not me, that's Eminem with brown hair. And I thought, how horrible. Because for a second I didn't know my own face, and I didn't know the mask that was wrapped around my skull. How strange. And so for a year I did a project where I embodied his aura and his affect and tried to understand this misunderstood creature. I tried to, in some ways, touch against this icon or push up against this icon and know him better or know him differently than the world did, because I thought, if he has my face, why can't I have his? And so I created a small show in Redford at a gallery called Wake Gallery, which was run by two artists, Andrew Mihal and Tony Hope. And I thought it was an apt time to be thinking about Eminem, given I was showing here in Michigan. And I think that the show was kind of a failure, but had interesting nuggets of ideas that I continue to kind of deal with in terms of how to create a space. That soda machine had axe ice cubes inside of it and was emitting fog, and the soda machine kind of had a standoff with a video of myself as Eminem eating cereal. I later went on to make another show with this Eminem character called Thousand Island. And at the time, Anderson Cooper had done an interview with Eminem on 60 Minutes, in which they were both talking about homophobia and dealing with sex politics and race politics and what it means to be the only rapper, only white rapper in a black man's game. And it was kind of strange because years later, Anderson Cooper came out of the closet, but at the time was proposing that he was straight. And I thought, everyone wears masks. So I made a fictional psychology test between Anderson and Eminem, which is a beautiful test that I highly recommend you do, in which you ask a person to describe a desert. And in that desert, there is a cube, and there's also a ladder and a horse and some flowers, and you describe them all and what their size is, what their texture is, where they are in relationship to each other. And then a storm comes. And it's a beautiful way of painting a picture if you're not an artist, in the same sense that making a bong is a beautiful way of making a sculpture if you're not an artist. These were Eminem's test results. This is a great book, children's book, if there's any children in the room, called Harold and the Purple Crayon, and I highly recommend it. I've always been drawn to this, no pun intended, book, because Harold sort of makes the world he needs to make and lives in it. And when the world requires more, he does more. There's a really beautiful moon tonight, by the by. And so, a few years after I was doing the Eminem project, I was thinking a lot about Rimbaud and his beautiful poem, A Season in Hell. And that poem is rich and beautiful because, in a similar sense, that these works are collaged materials, materials that were other people's, he collages words in a kind of abstract, kind of brutal way to describe something that we don't know, called hell. And I thought, how beautiful and how rich and how luxe is this world, because he made hell, for the first time in my eyes, feel fun. And so for the last several years, I've been unraveling that poem, its 9 parts, piece by piece, taking his words and making a world of my own. And the world kind of approximates my real world, using the things that I find in it and saying, are there clouds in hell? This was called Delirium One, The Foolish Virgin. This is a subsequent installation called A Night in Hell. I kind of want to quickly move through these just so I can cover all the ground I need to. And so I think of these rooms as portraits of people's minds. The poem A Season in Hell speaks of the loss that Rimbaud endures when he loses his lover Verlaine, and it makes him go crazy, when he loses this idea of touch. This is a portrait of my sister who loves to take selfies. And these are what I believe to be her rods and cones. And as you see, there are rods and cones in the room. There are also shampoo bottles that are labelless. And all the shampoo bottles do this cool thing in which they kind of squash space and time by proposing that their scents are going to take you on vacation for 69 cents. With names like Lavender Breeze or Vanilla Sunset. And I think taking a selfie is extremely cool because it does that too. It instantly makes you a movie star. It instantly puts you on the other side of the screen. It's like cooler than Poltergeist. This is a still from a collaboration I did recently with Jason Musson. And this was a prompt by a curator at the ICA in Philadelphia in which we were to work on part of our practice that we weren't normally working with. Mine was video and his was text. So he wrote a 15,000 word script to accompany my 2.5 hour videos, which are 4-channel and exist in the round. The title of the work, Eastern Sports, deals with ways in which we fetishize the other or ways in which we fetishize the things we can't have and long to touch, and how we construct our sense of self through the things we want and the things we can't have. This is an image of Eastern Sports. This is an image of a show called Deviltown. Thinking of this line of desire, if I think about the animation celluloid, that clear line between control and chaos, is similar to the fence that goes in front of someone's house in the suburbs. This was my version of Waiting for Godot, but set in the suburbs. The tree is both a portrait of my mother and my father, and the fence divided the space into four, each section a portrait of one of my siblings. I arrived at this kind of working, this way of setting things up and not using the wall primarily, when I was watching a film called Dogville by Lars von Trier. And I thought, how powerful to say much without doing much. This notion of black box theater makes the person who goes to see the show the star. And I think when seeing these shows in real life, it's best to watch someone else watch them because it puts the camera behind the person's head. This is an installation called Taught I Taw. And when I was asked to do the show in Lyon, I was thinking about Joni Mitchell and her ailment called Morgellons disease. And Morgellons is a sort of delusional disease in which people see fibers growing out of their arms that aren't really there. And in her album Blue, she made this really great song about California. And I thought, how cool to make a song about the color yellow, California, on an album called Blue. How cool to talk about something that isn't there with something else. And so I thought, can you push through that field of vision or that screen that we see? You know, we only have these eyes and they'll never change, but they do. And how do you do that? How do you flip something on its head? And so I took a bunch of things that were typically yellow and put them in the room. And there's this kind of visual, I don't know what you would call it, a kind of magic that happens with your eyes when you're inundated with one color, called the Ganzfeld effect. And if you're given a full volume of blue, when you leave that room, you will see its opponent color, in this case, yellow. And so my desire was to only use things that were typically yellow. Here we have McDonald's architecture, which are typically on the top of a McDonald's and are yellow. We have Marge Simpson in the back, but no body. And a man here dressed as Big Bird with no yellow feathers. The name Tot I Tall, tall is a protein, and when it, that exists in your brain, and when the protein deteriorates, you begin to have Alzheimer's, and you begin to not see things clearly, or you see things differently, and you believe them to be the thing that they are. And taut, meaning tightness, if you were to have tight, tall proteins, you would believe what you see, and what you see was real. Not too dissimilar to Joni Mitchell's ailment. And it also is a play on words, famously quoted by Tweety Bird, taut I taut puttycat, because he always, always fucking did. So this is one of the most recent shows I've done that happened in the beginning of the year. It is another version of A Season in Hell. The chapter is called Lightning. I just completed it, so I'm not really so sure how to break it down, but briefly, it is very much like the multiplane camera that Disney invented, and each one of these 8 planes creates a picture, with the very background being a lightning bolt created by Joseph Beuys called Lightning with Stag and its glare. It is, to me, a deconstructed house. And the other day when I was awake at night, because I often don't sleep, I was thinking, man, hell is a house you live in, or hell is a house you can live in. And so this is pieces of homes I've seen on television that I've brought to real life. Pieces of The Grinch, pieces of Clue, pieces of The Simpsons. All films where homes have been ransacked or altered or invaded or swatted. This is Beetlejuice. This is Nicole Brown Simpson's dog, which they say is the only witness to her murder. This is a swan and some pancakes. There was these kids sitting around this pond, and they were all looking at these swans, and the swans circle around each other. And both the swans' necks are turned backwards, so they're not seeing each other. And they were like, what is this about? And I was like, it's about unrequited love. And they're like 3 years old or 4 years old. And I'm like, do you know what that is? And they're like, no. And I was like, well, look at those pancakes. And they said, okay. I said, what do you think about when you see those pancakes? They're like, I'm really hungry and I want to eat them. And I was like, well, you can't have them. This is Joseph Beuys' Lightning with Stag and its Glare. And when you look at this whole installation from the other end of the room, it exists like a flat picture, like a Giotto painting. And the lightning bolt exists in the background like the tornado in Wizard of Oz. This is an image from a show I did several years ago called Fun Sponge, and I think I brought this in just to show that I like working with other people's work, Joseph Beuys being the most recent, and this being some early versions of that. I think a lot about favorites. This is my favorite picture. This is my favorite song. And what makes something your favorite? And can your favorite be my favorite? Can your eyes be my eyes? Can your painting be my painting? Can you kiss me through the phone? This is an installation I did at the Boijmans Museum in Rotterdam last year, in which I used their collection to tell a story and also undo the things that I loved. I like to use other people's works and borrow them because sometimes I just don't understand them and I need to touch them. I've always liked to touch paintings and used to kiss them when I was younger. And I was at the museum, I would secretly lick them. This is a Gilbert and George photograph with a Richard Serra color-aid video embedded in it. And an Alex Israel painting that looks like a tombstone. This is a Barbara Hepworth piece in front of a Rinica Dijkstra photograph. And there is a floss lamp looking in the wrong hole for the right girl. And that's an amazing Baldessari piece right to the left, which has a little picture of Jaws in it. A few months ago, I did a show in Denmark using Mr. Andy Warhol's personal belongings, including all 50 of his wigs. And I don't have much to say about this, besides it was weird. And they were still like wet, which was cool. And that I broke one of his things. And so, time moves on. This is an installation shot of A Season in Hell in LA. And I'll quickly, and this is the most recent show I did, called A Man Full of Trouble. And very briefly, I'll tell you about it. This is an inn where people like Ben Franklin would go and drink and relieve their woes. And I thought, man, there was Men Full of Trouble in 1759. How strange. Here I am in 2016, and I'm a man full of trouble as well. Maybe things haven't changed, and maybe time can be squashed too. And how are the things that existed then not too dissimilar to the things that exist now? And so I started to unpackage old pieces of furniture and also contemporary objects and place them in this gallery setting. And I made the carpet a scene from this film called It's a Mad, Mad, Mad World, in which all of these people are looking for money, and at the very end of the movie, they dig up a hole to look for this money, and they all look in. And so all of these faces, these kind of distorted sort of selfie faces are looking into this pit, and the pit is the gallery. Because a gallery is a pit where money lives. And all the stuff in it is, in some ways, here to relieve your woes. Do I have time to show a video? Okay. It's just a quick one. So I was recently asked to make a video for the Whitney Museum that will be displayed in Times Square in February. And they asked me to make this video, and the video would exist on every screen in Times Square at midnight every night for a month. And I thought that was strange to have my work be trapped inside of a TV like that. And this is what it is. And no one's seen it yet.
Blue moon, you saw me standing alone. Blue moon, you knew just what I was there.
Thank you.
Thank you.